I had a very bad intro slide, but I took it out to follow the rules.
Yes.
So I have three slides.
It's not that important. So here we are. Houston Arboretum, we're at the, does this even have it? So we're at the junction between 610 and Whitway. And we're right by the Galleria, we're moments from downtown Houston, so we're really in the heart of central Houston. And we're 10% of Memorial Park. We are part of park land, but we're also function as a private nonprofit. And so what we have here is we're in this urban context. And so what happened historically, because of anthropogenic reasons, we've limited fire, grazing, all the disturbances that kept these kind of savanna, post-oak savanna, Gulf Coast prairie systems in place. And so the site became overwooded. And what we had were two disasters. We had the Ike and then the culmination of the drought. And that really opened the Arboretum's eyes to the relationship with the landscape. And they started to rethink their role and that they could be more proactive and more hands-on in their management. And what we see here in the second diagram is the design team. They went through an effort of going through a master plan exercise, and they were seeing that most of the canopy mortality, they lost over 50% of their tree canopy in both of these events, and they saw that there was a relationship between the soils and that the upper, but this area here are the historic native soils. And so the master plan vision was to increase these diverse ecosystems, to restore them and bring them back to site, and that eventually it would be more resilient over time, so that if we can mimic these disturbances, that when a large disaster happens, that it will be able to withstand these and it'll be a healthier site overall. And so what we found, what we need, our restoration process, is that we're doing this is we are mimicking the fire regime. And one of the ways that we're doing this is we are clearing out our invasive understory. So we have a very strong, dense understory of ligustrum species, privet, yaupon, and cherry laurel that have really formed a thicket and a wall. And so what we've done is we've cleared this. This is an example of an area that we cleared with a hydro axe, and then we cleared other areas by hand. And so what we found to be successful is we did this as a test area, and we divided the site. We looked at, started thinking, how can we do this on a small scale and test out these methods? So up here, what we call Unit 1, we divided up the site based on the trail system. We're 155 acres. This is our savanna area, prairie restoration, and this is our woodland area. We did all the clearing here by hand with volunteer groups. We started in 2015. We're just now finishing the clearing. We did up here in this corner 5 acres in a period of 3 days with a hydro axe. And we have seen that if we can focus on these smaller areas and if we can stay on top of it, again, part of we have to do this major disturbance, but then if we just stay on top of it, we don't really have a problem with controlling our invasive species. Yes. We have to make peace with some of them, that some of them will be there, but we can still have a diverse ecosystem. This is a picture of, we went through two test plots, and we're testing different implementation strategies. Here is a picture of, there's three different strips, one where we seeded without any compost, one where we did 1-inch top dressing, and one where we air spaded compost in. And that was working with the design team. Initially, they wanted to rototill about 8 to 10 inches of compost throughout the whole site. And so we were kind of squeaky wheel and trying to make that not happen. So I guess my question and what I'd love to get some feedback on is now we're moving out of this phase where it's kind of smaller control. We've now started our master plan construction, which is pretty much unit 1 and 5. And then now we've started clearing, and here we've had Texas A&M Forest Service clear 8 acres here. We're now moving our volunteer concentrated work to extend on this unit 2, which is already has 3 acres of meadow here. And this is really our savanna, our prairie savanna, and this is more savanna, and this is our woodland zone. And And so what I'm struggling with is how do we record our daily work? We've got a wonderful team of six, and one of the things that we go out and we do this work, and do we do a daily log? It's not very fun. Do other organizations do that? How do we then look at that information and make decisions and see what we're doing? I'm wanting to come up with some sort of system, a systematic way of approaching these. Do we do it unit-based? Do we do it ecosystem-based? Do we do it seasonally? My thoughts are that we will kind of come up with a calendar and start thinking about like deep-rooted sedge. What time of the year is it best to go in and do things with that? Trumpet creeper, do we do it, invasive species based? When is the best time to mow? I want to test out different times of mowing, different times of planting. We've tested a couple of different seed mixes from Native American seed. One of the things we have found is that grasses haven't established as well as wildflowers. They just seem to be hanging out. Some in our pilot area are just still this tall. In the master plan, they do have a large percentage for plugs, and a lot of those plugs will be used kind of in the lower wetter areas where we're actually fun establishing. But so I guess that's my question, is trying to figure out how to, now that we're getting a little more complex and more diverse, how to document that and organize ourselves in a way where those invasive species aren't getting ahead of us, where we can stay on top of them.
Boom, perfect timing.
Yep.
Are you soil sandy or not? Are they pretty sandy?
They are sandy loamy. They vary. So we have the pimples and dimples, and yes. In the pimples, they're definitely sandier than in the dimples.
Well, my thought is, maybe you should put extra nutrients out there, because you might present invasives an opportunity for a really rich environment where they would move in and you have more of a winner-take-all mentality. Versus, I feel like a lot of times in the sandier, especially the sandier ridges, if you go out to some of these areas that are more native, there's a lot of diversity. The reason is there's not a couple species that are monopolizing all the area. We have like euphorbia, and also like species that are used to, I think, struggling in the nutrient poor environment. But I think that might eliminate at least some of your invasive issues, where if you don't try to pull nutrients, just get your canopy off there, maybe even try to get your canopy off there and not mulch. Let you get that bare ground showing. I mean, I've got a site where we mulch, and if I could have changed things, it would be not a mulch, but a tree run off there, and then just let go crazy, because the seed bank, for the most part, at least, this site was a canopy for at least 45 years. The seed bank was mostly there. There's enough light gaps that it came back. I mean, it's 40 acres, 245 species, something like that, though, so super rich. And that's would be one of my thoughts, yeah. For some of the areas. At least try it out.
That's a great point. So another problem we have is we have this huge amount of mulch. And what to do with it, and where some of it we need to store. I wanted to talk to the Memorial Park Conservancy. I know they're doing a biocycling program where they like some mulch. So what we did in our pilot area, we were very concerned about that layer of mulch and what it would do, but it broke down pretty fast. We're so wet. It did break down fast, and it didn't seem to inhibit our seeding. So that was a good thing. And we did see a lot of native things coming up on its own. That was one thing that we got indications that we're doing, moving it in the right direction. We don't want to be pushing it to Savannah just for the storyline. We want to do it because that's what the site wants to be.
I know that Chris is doing some pollinator research over there for you guys. Are you tracking how birds and other wildlife are responding? And it seems like what's happening in Memorial Park is going to create really great skunk habitat, and which is not a bad thing, but they're in Memorial, they're going to move over. So have you guys talked about that at all?
Well, we have Kelsey, who is a master's in ornithology, and so right. She has been helping us document and look at all the new species that have come in, and we've seen immediate changes. We've already seen the red-headed woodpecker.
Very cool.
So again, that's part of our indications that we're pushing things in the right direction. I don't know if you want to add to that, Chris.
I mean, we're doing a lot of vegetation monitoring too, so we'll permit plots throughout the site that we
right.
As we do restoration efforts, we hope to see lots of changes in the
and Cleo also needs a bird, a monthly bird walk?
A bird survey.
Bird survey.
Is your mulch the combination of your invasive species and the other trees, or is it, you know, what is your mulch?
That's a good question. Some of it is our invasive species, but what's happening in the master plan will be our trees. So it won't be the invasive species because the invasive species have already been cleared.
It's hard to distribute that invasive species mulch to people, innocent people.
Yes. Well, most of that we just blow back into the site.
You said that you had a test of using air spray compost and no compost and just a layer of compost. What happened? What's the result of those?
Sure. Essentially, and Chris did a lot of the monitoring for this, we didn't find a statistical difference between the three different treatments. But we did find just anecdotally, the top dressing seemed to be the one that had the best coverage and diversity. We did notice though with watering that when we didn't do any compost, that strip needed more frequent watering. But yet our watering regime was even less than what the Wildflower Center are writing the specs for the watering on this. So it was less than what they prescribed. So that was encouraging. It was also, we timed it right with the weather. So what we did find is that essentially in the savanna areas, that seed didn't establish well in the lower nipples, which is where we really want those grasses to be. So using plugs in those areas is something that we're gonna use as a strategy. Okay. Is anything else?
The question period's up.
Okay.
So what other comments would you like to make on what's going on in the
In the lower areas, if you don't mind huge clumps of grass, like eastern gamma grass, I got tons of it that I'm trying to get rid of. So if anybody wants to come and dig it out.
I don't know if you guys heard that back there, but Lan is offering massive quantities of eastern gamma grass.
You will take it.
You have to dig it out. Somebody.
Self-serve. Is it the shorter one or the taller one?
It's the taller one, unfortunately.
Okay.
Original provenance is from Stephen F. Austin State Park, I think. That's what somebody said. They planted it at a elementary school. Got too big for the site. I took a piece of it, and now it's huge.
How are you documenting?
Talk to Chris, you can't talk.
Oh.
So how are we documenting which part?
She was talking about that.
Yeah, that's my question.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's a lot of stuff that we document. So we're documenting like for example we have these plots where we're documenting changes in the plant communities over time, so we plan to revisit those every 3 or 4 years, something like that, and just see how the plant community changes over time. Are you more interested in that?
I think she was talking about documenting what you're doing on maybe a more daily basis or weekly basis.
Yeah, so we had started these things called daily logs where we were keeping track of every type of work that we were doing, how many of us were doing that type of work, including volunteers. So say we had volunteers working in the prairie one day, we'd want to get a count of how many volunteers we had. And then what kind of work we were doing and where we were on the site. So that way we can get an idea of what ecosystems require, you know, what kind of maintenance, how many hours they usually spend on a certain area versus another area.
Has anyone encountered a, and maybe Andy, an app or a some kind of web-based thing where you can catalog. We're running the same information. We just had to make a Google Doc or Google Form to input stuff if we wanted to track. But has anybody found a good application that allows you to document field work as you're doing it so that you get the data?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, we use a cloud-based system.
Useful that information. Is the information useful? Can you look at it and make decisions based on it?
We use it evaluate our programming. We use it for data for fundraising. We use it for reporting and marketing. We use it for everything. And also field work, what works and what doesn't. So best practices. Very important. And you can also collect images.
Something database related because and looking to like those logs might be a little bit easier because you just type out what you want, but then you have like thousands of logs and you have to search through it. So you need some sort of database management so you have fields that you can query so that you don't want to kill yourself later.
I did do some of that.
I mean, yeah, that's all we're using Microsoft based.
Okay.
So it's like Excel, database. And if we can group, we have different columns for different things, which management unit we're working in, how many you can rank things by, things like that. And I guess I can put it in that access.
So, I mean, obviously they use Google.